Good evening. This is Heartstock Radio, and I'm Carol Murphy. Thank you so much for being here. Remember that we're on Facebook. You can also email us at heartstockradio@gmail.com. We have a guest that I'm very excited for this evening. It's Kathleen Williams, who is the current Montana Democratic congressional candidate. We've extended also an invitation to her running mate, Greg Gianforte, in the spirit of fairness, just to put that out there. In just a moment, Kathleen will be back, and she's going to tell you all about what she's up to. This is Heartstock Radio, and I'm Carol Murphy, your host. Thanks for being here. Thanks for listening to Heartstock Radio. Our guest today is Kathleen Williams. Hi, Kathleen.
Hi there. Great to be with you.
Thank you so much. Please introduce yourself to our listeners, many of who probably know who you are, but just in case.
Sure. Happy to, Carol. I'm Kathleen Williams. I'm running for U.S. Congress against Greg Gianforte. A little bit about my background and why I'm running is I have a 35-year career in natural resource problem solving and a three-term state legislator where I worked on healthcare and business issues and was elected during the recession. So worked real hard on policies that could help us diversify our economy and create opportunity. So I've lived in Montana for 24 years and just tried to serve this wonderful state in as many ways as possible for that entire time. And I ran for the legislature because I saw a lot of dysfunction and hyper-partisanship and ineffectiveness, and now I'm seeing that in Washington. So I want to go and turn those skills to helping Congress get functional again and work better for Montana. So,
yeah, we could sure use some of that. I'm with you there for sure. Tell us, I'm always so curious about our guests' personal stories and their background. What motivated you to go into public service?
Well, I think I come from a family of public service, especially military. My father was in World War II. He was a lieutenant colonel. My husband was a Vietnam era veteran, and he was a lifetime career USDA employee. He worked for Natural Resources Conservation Service, which used to be the Soil Conservation Service, and worked with farmers and ranchers in the various states that he worked in, most recently in Montana. And I've just always really valued both the opportunity and the responsibility and the honor of serving the public and trying to find win-win-win solutions in this sort of overcomplicated world we have, and developed what I like to think is a skill and an art in doing that, and just want to continue to be able to help.
Let's delve a little bit deeper, if we could. Where were you born, and what brought you to Montana? Were you born here? It seems to me like maybe you lived that gypsy life of a military
Well,
family.
I did move around quite a bit. I moved to Montana 24 years ago from Oregon. I had been there 6 years. Prior to that, I was in Colorado doing graduate work, which is where I fell in love with the Rockies. I actually was born in an Army hospital in San Francisco, and I did grow up in the Bay Area. It took me a while to find Montana, but when I did, it's the first place for me that ever felt like home, and I've been here ever since. So that's been 24 years.
When you were doing your graduate studies, was that related to natural resources? It just sounds to me like you have a really strong background and orientation towards managing natural resources.
I do. In fact, my first fascination with natural resource policy was in my undergraduate education, and I just got fascinated with both how complex those types of issues are and also how important they are. And my undergraduate degree is in, I call it resource economics. It actually has a longer name, but the idea that you can't necessarily measure the value of many of our resources in market terms was something that I got fascinated with and tried to help find proxies to be able to talk about the value of our outdoors and our natural resources when we make decisions. And then in Colorado, my work was, it was actually an outdoor recreation, but I spent my technical work doing hydraulic modeling and hydrology and fisheries work because my professional project was to do an in-stream flow quantification for a recreational river that ran through town to help the Forest Service decide what type of or the amount of the water right that they wanted to apply for or quantify because it was a wild and scenic river. And so so the degree was in a master's in recreation resources, but I found myself doing a lot of engineering and biology work and then creating a very, you know, early version of a decision support system that allowed the Forest Service to see how recreational opportunity changed with different flow levels to allow them to use that tool to choose what water levels they were going to file to quantify for the recreational value.
Yeah, and that's right up our alley in Montana. There's a huge benefit to the citizens. I think there's also a huge economic value because we have huge tourist industry that comes for, well, just fishing and hunting, let alone the natural beauty.
And I also spent 5 years working across the state in balancing the needs of irrigators and water users that divert water from our rivers and balancing that with the health of our rivers. And that was during 5 straight years of drought. Mm. So those are challenging times. And but we can find ways to bring people together and find really win-win-win solutions to thorny natural resource issues. And that's what I enjoy doing. And I take that and I apply that approach to healthcare or to business creation. And it works to bring people together to talk about their needs and hopes and struggles and dreams and see if we can develop policy that balances those moving forward.
Hmm. So what was your attraction to natural resources? Did you spend a lot of time in the outdoors and just have an affinity for that? Or was it just something that kind of evolved and unfolded over time?
Well, I did. I was the youngest of 4 girls. My father always wanted a son. In fact, I didn't even have a first name on my birth certificate when I was born. I was supposed to be Tom. So I guess my dad decided that given that he got yet a fourth daughter, that he was just going to take me fishing and tramping around the outdoors. And so I got to spend wonderful times with my father fishing. We had a cabin in the mountains. He would take 3 weeks of vacation every summer and the family would go to the family cabin and we'd fish and swim and boat and just enjoy the forest and the lake.
Well, that's kind of how I grew up, and I know it had a very lasting and deep impression on me here in Montana. What I would really like to focus on for the rest of the show is really talk about your philosophy as it applies to business and doing that better in Montana. You've had a lot of roundtable discussions, and I really am thrilled at your approach by listening to people a lot. Can you talk about your general philosophy for doing business better here?
I am interested in not top-down approaches, but this sort of fostering of collaborative approaches and local approaches where those things work. I've been talking to economic development folks across the state, and there's just all kinds of really great things going on that are integrations of a variety of either different programs or just different entrepreneurial types of efforts. And it seems to me that when our educational system and our economic development folks and our business community and our city and regional planners all are communicating well and fostering each other's efforts and not duplicating as much as we can, that there's just all kinds of opportunities in both urban and rural Montana to foster business, to foster quality of life, which is so related to business, and to ensure that we're removing barriers where we can and we're fostering opportunities where we can as well. So my approach has really been to bring people together to talk about their interests, their needs, what's going well, what needs to be improved. And if there's a federal nexus there, then I really want to know how I can help. But otherwise, I want to congratulate folks and just encourage them to continue to do the good work that they're doing. So that's why I'm bringing folks together, is to try and generate those good ideas and not get in the way when good things are happening.
So what have you found needs fixing?
Well, I'll tell you that, again, when I was a state legislator, what I valued so much was being what I called a true representative, which was being grounded in the hopes, struggles, and dreams of my district, which at that point was a very eastern slice of the city of Bozeman, but then all of eastern Gallup County, and then rolling up my sleeves and going to Helena and working on that. And what I heard then were both the need for economic diversity, because that was during the recession and Bozeman had been very dependent on the construction industry, and any community that is an economy that is dependent significantly on one sector, there is a risk there of, if that sector struggles, that there can be some pretty significant repercussions to the community. So I wanted to diversify our economy, and then I was hearing about healthcare issues. And so those are the things that I went to Helena to work on, and I think I was fairly successful. And now what I'm hearing statewide, again, as I talk to people and groups, and both in person and by phone, and is healthcare is once again, or continues to be, what I hear most broadly, most deeply, and most urgently that we need to fix, that is relevant to the federal level. I'm glad I have some experience in that policy arena, and I look forward to hitting the ground running. We just had a healthcare roundtable today with some really good information and some really good sharing from members of the public and some experts in the industry. So that's one thing that I'm hearing that really needs to be worked on.
I would really like to see things like hemp textiles or hemp wool textiles manufacturing brought to Montana. It seems like a really awesome fit. And I know that you've done some work in this area with agriculture. Can you talk a little bit about some of the possibilities for innovation and what we can do to bolster our economy locally?
Yeah. So one of the things I'm most proud of is, there's several business-oriented pieces of legislation that I sponsored in the legislature, but one that was really both fun and important, I think, was we called it the Food Policy Modernization Act. But what I was trying to do, what I set out to do at the beginning, was to pass what's called a cottage food bill. It allows people to make certain non-hazardous foods in a home kitchen and market them and sell them. So we started out doing that in 2013, and the bill draft that I ended up with, we started out a little late on it because a friend of mine, a colleague, asked me to work on it, and we got started a little bit late. But what I ended up with then was not something that I liked, and I don't think anyone else liked it either. And we also discovered while we were working on that bill was that our food laws were just an absolute mess for both food trucks and, you know, other food-related businesses. There's three different agencies that are involved in food safety. And so I converted that starter of a bill in 2013 into a bill that required those three agencies to go with me around the state and not only help me create a cottage food law, but to try and fix the mess that we were creating for our farmers markets and our food trucks and our small food businesses. And so we did that. The agencies were wonderful. We did write a cottage food bill, and we embedded it. It was embedded in this broader bill that removed a lot of this red tape that wasn't working. And so we fixed a lot of problems, and then we created the Cottage Food Act, which people under that act have created over 170 new businesses and over 2,000 new Montana products just within 2 years of the enactment of that. And that information is already almost a year old, so I'm sure there's quite a few more. But a lot of those businesses are in rural Montana. There's three of them just in Shodo alone. And many of them use Montana agricultural products as inputs. And so I'm a strong believer in diversifying our economy, both in urban and rural areas, in value-added types of business opportunities, in allowing people or providing opportunities where people can try out a business idea and then onboard it if they find that it's successful, and not have to invest, you know, huge amounts of money to try something out. So this was just the perfect example of all those things that I value so much in work in economic development and rural vitality. So many of those businesses, some of those businesses I've been able to visit as I campaign, and they're very diverse. There's people supplementing their retirement income with the products that they're making at home. There's a guy who tried out some products at home and has already invested in a commercial kitchen and is taking his product real mainstream, and just story after story of how this opportunity has really helped both people, local economies, and the producers that are providing the input.
Yeah. Those are beautiful stories. We're just a little bit over our halfway point, and we're going to take a short little break. Please enjoy. We'll be right back. Thanks for listening. This is Heartstock. This is Heartstock Radio. I'm Carol Murphy, your host. Our guest this evening is Kathleen Williams. Hi, Kathleen.
Hi.
Thank you so much for being here. And we were just talking about doing business better in Montana, and I'd like to kind of address a couple political issues that really spill over into business, and there's a huge interconnection between the two. And one of them, I think, relates to a subject that you talked on before, which is working across the aisle. You've called yourself both an independent and a Democrat. And I'm wondering how that's all washing out for you. How does the existing powers that be in the Democratic Party, how do they feel about that?
Well, I do have a D after my name. A lot of people know that I evaluated whether to run for the legislature as an independent. I also evaluated whether to do that for Congress, run as an independent. But I pride myself I don't even like to use the term aisle, because that to me connotes a divide. I talk about working with people of all political stripes to find win-win-win solutions for the betterment of Montana and and in this case, the nation. So I think that has served me very well. I believe I am well known among my legislative colleagues for rolling up my sleeves and finding very unique places where I can find common interests with people that some might find it unexpected. On healthcare issues, I was able to, well, when you're in the minority in the legislature, you have to work with the other party to get things done or you can't get anything passed. So that's a given. But my style has always been very collaborative and cooperative. And I do feel like the hyper-partisan nature of our politics today is one of the reasons I'm running, is I want to turn that around and ensure that our institutions function rather than just focus on which party is going to be in power or mm-hmm. trying to make the other one fail. So I think that's worked well for me as far as what the party thinks about it. I think they have a good candidate. I obviously ran in the primary and the party did not take a position there. And I have been invited and asked to serve in partisan leadership and in the legislature, and I've declined to do that, instead turning my leadership interest to vice-chairing committees. So I vice-chaired the Agricultural Committee in 2013. I vice-chaired the House Taxation Committee in 2015. And those are opportunities to build a team with your caucus colleagues and then also the other members on the committee and ensure that the committee runs well, that the state is offered excellent policy proposals from those committees, an excellent process. So I consider myself to have a little D after my name and to really be interested in the best interests of all of Montana, not just a certain party.
Yeah, and it does seem very commonsensical that would take priority. And I love that approach, which kind of leads me to a next question, because there's just this hierarchy that seems to be controlled by money. And in Montana, certainly dark money and people's personal fortunes can wield a lot of power. How are you dealing with all of that? Not having, I'm just assuming here, I hope correctly, that you don't have a personal fortune like your opponent from which to draw funding.
Well, you're correct. I do not have a personal fortune. And my opponent is one of the wealthiest members of Congress, if not the wealthiest. So that can be daunting for someone who wants to run for public office in this day and age, because of all the money that both you need to get your message out and what pours in on various sides. I have committed to not taking corporate PAC money. So,
and why is that so important?
Well, what that means is that I don't have the interests of big corporations contributing to my campaign. So I also talk to people about the fact that, well, number one, we need to elect people like me that understand that this is a pretty crazy way to try and become a public servant with all this money, and that we need campaign finance reform. Mm-hmm. But to do that, to get campaign finance reform in this system, we need campaign finances to be able to get there. And races are expensive. I am incredibly honored that most of my donors are from Montana. We are attracting broader attention in this race now. And so we are taking money as it comes in, and people are being generous. So we appreciate that. Just says that people care about this race and feel like we can get better representation. Mm-hmm. I will say, too, that I tell people there is an issue with all the money in elections, and we need to ensure that we address that. But we also need to elect people that aren't corrupted by that money, that are right, that are running for the right reasons, that are running to be a public servant, that are running to fix problems policy-wise and aren't don't get stars in their eyes when they get offered junkets and things like that. And so I think a lot of my legislative colleagues know that, for example, when groups would pay for committee dinners at the end of the session, I would always get my checkbook out and ask them how much my dinner cost and pay for my dinner. When I got football tickets from Montana State University for my husband and I would pay for my tickets. And I didn't see any other legislator doing that. And in fact, those checks sometimes took months to cash because they had no idea what to do with them. That was such an unusual thing for someone to do. So the money is one thing, but also we need to ensure that the people we're sending aren't corruptible by the money. So that's two pieces. And I think I'm the type of candidate that is running for the right reasons. I've proven that in the legislature, and I'll continue that tradition in Congress.
So other than Janet Rankin, if my research is correct, Montana has never sent a woman to Congress. What do you think about that?
She was elected in 1916, so 102 years ago, and then reelected in the 40s. But she was the first woman elected to any national legislative body in the world. Mm. So Montana was a trendsetter then, but unfortunately the trend since then has been that we haven't sent a woman since. I like to think that it's many people are telling me that it's wonderful to have the opportunity to vote for a woman, and I always say, and of course, not only a woman, but the most qualified candidate as well.
So the sad moment has again arrived and we've run out of time. How should folks reach you?
So the website is KathleenForMontana.com. It's all words, all spelled out. And there's links there to our Facebook page and our Instagram, and there's on YouTube. There's lots of fun videos we've been doing, and there's an opportunity for people to submit questions or input through that page. So if they want to volunteer, they can. There's offices in 13 cities in Montana, cities and towns, and so they can get more information there. It's the Tester Williams combined campaign.
Thank you so much, Kathleen, for being on Heartstock.
Thank you, Carol.
And we wish you the best of luck. Appreciate it.
Thanks so much.
We'll see. This is Heartstock Radio, and I'm Carol Murphy. See you next week. Bye bye.
No sign it said, no trespass.
Heartstock Radio is a production of KBMF 102.5, Butte America Radio. Hear our live programs every Friday at 5 p.m. Mountain Standard Time via live stream at ButteAmericaRadio.org.